Hi, my name is Barbara Jean Cluen Dunbar, and I really would like to share my testimony today about coming from Mormonism to Christ. And I'm very, very grateful for our Heavenly Father for all that He's given me, and just praise the Lord for my relationship with Him. And I want to thank Rob and his family, all that they do to help bring people to Christ, because it's a great, great thing. So I was born at a very early age, and actually I'm from Mystic, Connecticut, and I came from a very tumultuous background, and I have like 11 brothers and sisters, but they're halves and quarters and step, and my father married my mother's sister at a young age, even, and he's not even known to be a polygamist, but I think he married her before he divorced my mom. So a lot of things were really, really crazy in my life. And when you live like that, you're so out of control, you keep trying to control. So it was very interesting. I started, drinking and smoking at a young age. I quit smoking at 12, and quit drinking at 15. So at one point in my life, I was a Baptist. And I was raised by a Baptist family, not a Baptist. Well, my mother was Baptist, her whole family was Baptist. And I went to the Baptist church down the street quite a bit. Things got so crazy in my family, my friends couldn't come over because there was so much fighting and stuff going on. So, but I did have a dear friend, Marianne, and her grandparents who taught Sunday school. And they taught me about the gospel, and they taught me about, it was so cool that, Rob Starr said the Lord's Prayer this morning, because that's one thing, you know, I had for memory that I'd always repeat. Anyway, they taught me a lot of things, and we did read the Bible. And so I remember the times I'd cry myself to sleep at night, and I'd say, God, please help me. And I remember the time when God said, I'm right here for you. So I began my journey when I was about 15, I don't know, for some reason, I just was out in search of the true church. So I studied everything from Buddha to what Helen Keller was teaching and Catholics. Being back east, I thought it must be the Catholic Church. There's so many of them. So I kept studying, and then I was hanging out with a gal that was really kind of, yeah, her husband was in the Coast Guard, and I was like 15, and she was 25, and we hung out, and one day I went to the fridge to get a beer. And it was like the middle of August in Connecticut, and there was two guys sitting on our couch, and they had suits and ties on, and it was like humid as anything, and I thought, what are they doing there? And that one guy's kind of cute, but I wonder what he's doing here. Well, they were the Mormons, and I don't know how they got there, but one of them got transferred to another mission. I'd never seen him again, and they got transferred to another mission. Once they get transferred to another mission, they can write to you. You know, they can't call you or talk to you. And so he would write to me. And then I had three Mormons in my high school. And so he introduced me to them. And so I would talk to them and go places and do things with them. And it was very nice. It's like, you know, like I say, it was an escape from the reality of what was going on at my house, for sure. And I always asked myself the question, had my friends from my other church stayed in touch with me, had I still been in that. One of the things that Mormonism teaches is that Joseph Smith discovered that God came to Joseph Smith and told him about the book, the Word of Wisdom, that, you know, you weren't supposed to drink alcohol, coffee, tobacco, and all those things. And I think that's one of the things that drew me to Mormonism, because I was on my way to drug addiction and alcoholism, and I didn't want to do what the rest of the family had done in many ways. And so, back to this guy, he was very good looking, and so he wrote to me and sent me a book, and he sent me this book called Added Upon, and it's about two people from pre-existence who come down and they meet and they fall in love and get married. No, it wasn't Rusty, my husband, now. It was this other missionary. So his name was Joe Squire. He's from Orem, Utah. Anyway, I joined the church when I was 15. He sent me the Book of Mormon. And in the Book of Mormon, not only in Moroni 10:7 that says, when you receive these things, you know, no, that's James. He was asking about ask God, if these things are not true, and you will receive a burning in your heart. Isn't that interesting? It says, if these things are not true, you will receive a burning in your heart. And I thought, oh my, I never saw that not until recently. Yeah. And then Alma 45:45, that talked about if you wanted to really find the truth, to fast and pray. That's the best way to you know, get rid of problems, find the truth. And so I did that. And then I went to my room, and lo and behold, I had a Joseph Smith experience too. I was kneeling and praying and asking God if those things were true, and I had this great overwhelming darkness come over me, and I prayed to God to please to you know, help me overcome this. And so that was interesting because he did. So then I knew the church was true. After that, I joined the church. I quit drinking, and it was really great. I joined the church, and I'd been in the church about 2 years. And I finally had to leave home because my mom and her boyfriend, they were just fighting, and he was beating her up all the time and stuff. And I left home, and she went to her first AA meeting. She said, I'm here because my daughter left home. So that was a wonderful thing that happened. And I went and lived with some friends for a while. And then I went off to Rick's College because I wanted to be with all the saints. And I knew the guy I was going to marry was at BYU. And I didn't want to get married. I just wanted to be a psychologist and go on a mission and do those things. And I was at Rick's. And lo and behold, they called me to teach the gospel doctrine class to the returned missionaries. Like, hello, I didn't even know anything about the church, and these guys have just come back after 2 years. And nevertheless, they filled the class, and then I met Rusty, and just when I was getting ready to leave Rick's College to go to BYU, and so we've been married now for like 45 years. So. Anyway, we were both active in the church. We got married at the Manti Temple, 1971. We have 5 children and 12 of the best grandchildren in the world. And so we kind of had a tumultuous marriage because he came from a perfect family and I came from a screwed up family. And a lot of things, you know, I pretty much raised myself, so I didn't know a lot about marriage or, you know, what to do. I just thought, oh, as long as I keep controlling things, you know. When I joined the church, it was so cool because I didn't have to think anymore. I didn't have to control things. I just got to do everything they asked me to do. I went to the temple hundreds of times. Hundreds, literally hundreds of times. I went to the temple. There was a time when we moved to Florida and came back to Denver, and I didn't want to be in Denver. But I got a blessing that said, you chose in the pre-existence to be here. So, you know, they asked us to work in the temple then, there. So there was a lot of things that, you know, really kept us going, kept our family going, and kept, you know, there's a lot of good things. I don't know, but I think they were more out of fear than commitment to the Lord or commitment to one another that kept us going. And I was thinking about... the time that I so didn't want to be there in Denver. And so then as soon as I got a blessing that told me I was supposed to be here because I chose to be here, you know, it's better. So it's kind of interesting because, I don't know, I believe there are no accidents, you know, that God was in a lot of that still. So about, when was it, 2001 that we moved here to Utah? 1998, when one son was going on a mission, and my daughter was going on a mission, and so my sister-in-law called and wanted us to come to Utah because I'm in real estate, and I got her involved in real estate, and I was going to go into commercial real estate. So I prayed about it, and I got up, and I remember God said, you can go, but it's for a much bigger reason. And fortunately, Rusty had a job that was over, covered several states, so he could go to Utah too. So we moved. We moved to Utah, and it was very interesting. I would always brag about how I was in Zion among all the saints and stuff. So I really feel like I might be missing something here because I'm going pretty fast, aren't I? anyway, this when we moved to Utah, again, we had the five kids and had a great time kind of raising our kids and raising other people's kids. You know, again, we still had really tumultuous times. So when our kids all left home, then we moved. We moved to this condo, and it was the first time we got to move to a new place, get new furniture in 38 years. And Rusty started questioning the church, and that was the end. I mean, I thought, oh boy, now that he's questioning the church, what else? What do we have in common anymore? And you know, he would say things, you know, he just mentioned things, you know, about Joseph Smith and his wives and different things, and his many wives. And so I just thought, well, you know, you need a psychiatrist. You need to go to a psychiatrist. I've been telling you this for years, but now you're questioning the church. Something really wrong with you. And what was interesting after that was, I said, if you can tell me something good, I'll listen. But before that, he had a really good friend named Curtis who he worked with. And he would talk to him on the phone for hours during the day. And then he'd hang up the phone and he'd say, I'd say, well, what were you guys talking about? And he said, well, we were talking about Christ or this or that. And Curtis says he's going to be praying for us. And I thought, who does he think he is? You know, praying for us. He's not Mormon. So, and yet he just was patient, you know, for years and years. And, you know, we're talking earlier about the seeds that are planted, and different seeds are planted all the time. And we look back at the things that were told in our life and thought about, and different people that would say things. And we can look back now and say, what if we grabbed on then? What if we did then? Whatever. So anyway, we Rusty continued to check out things like that. And I thought, don't say that, it hurts my heart. Then I finally said, no, that's it. I'm going out to California. I'm going to be a missionary at the Optimum Health Institute, which is where they have healings. It's a non-denominational place where they do healings through eating right, you know, and eating natural foods and drinking wheatgrass and stuff like that. So I said, and, you know, even though I was kind of a control freak, and I said, well, we got three houses. It was during 2008 when the market went down, and I had three houses that I bought, and two of them weren't doing very well. So I mentioned to my husband that I would put one on the internet. I'd put them all for rent while I left, and he could go stay at the one that didn't rent. If ours rented, he could go stay at the other ones because he's gone so much. And so he wasn't really paying attention to what I was saying. I don't think he even knew I had it for rent. And then so I got a call, one call, that's all. And lo and behold, these people, this guy from Vermont called, and you know, he was a ski bum, I thought. So I didn't want to rent my place to him. And he called about it, and for some reason, you know, I didn't get this big aha or anything. I just called him right back and we got talking. And he said, well, can we come over Sunday? And I thought, Sunday? No. I wear a dress on Sunday and nylons, and I don't do business on Sunday. But I wanted to get out of there, so I let him come over to see the house to rent. And when my husband heard that I had somebody coming over, he wasn't too happy about that. And so then he said, well, ding dong, the doorbell rang. And Rich and Ellen came to our door, and Ellen was smiling, and I just fell in love with both of them right away. And I thought, oh, I got new friends. So they saw the house, and they looked around at our house. And again, Rusty was upstairs. And he'd been, well, let me go back, because he'd been reading the Bible, finally. He was reading the Bible, and we wanted to go to a Christian bookstore and get a, he was sure that there was a study Bible. There must be one. So we went to a Christian bookstore, and to a Mormon, oh my gosh, that felt so strange going in there. I was looking to see if anybody was watching me, you know, going in this Christian bookstore. And it was interesting because I took out, he was looking at all the Bibles, and I was looking at all the books about Mormonism, and I was thinking, oh, those bad people writing those books. And I saw this book called Born Again Mormon by Sean McCraney. And I just thought, wow, I should read that book for some reason. Or maybe I can just hype up Rusty enough to realize it's really true. He was born again. This guy was born again, and he's a good Mormon. And so we did buy the book. And then, I had said to Rusty, if you can tell me something good, I'll listen. And so he started reading me the Bible. And I would say, I thought Joseph Smith said that. No, it's right here in the Bible. No, I thought he said that. And you know, it didn't take but a few days before I thought, he lied about a lot of things. And then this Sean McCraney guy, he was on TV doing the Born Again Mormon show. And I didn't want Rusty to know I was watching him, because he was the one going apostate, not me. But I thought I'd just watch. One day I turned on the TV, and there he was, and he was talking about the Word of Wisdom. And I thought, oh my goodness, Joseph Smith lied about that too. Because, you know, Kellogg had come out with the Word of Wisdom way before Joseph Smith did that. But I enjoyed watching Sean, so I'd always sneak and watch him, and Rusty would sneak and watch him, and we didn't tell each other that that's what we were doing. So then the knock came at the door with Rich and Elle, and my husband was a little upset. We'd go through the whole house. I didn't have any temples in the house, but I had a big sign that said, Christ is the center of our lives, in our office. So we're in the office, and Rusty was sitting over here, and he had his back to my company. And luckily, they were brave enough, and this is where I want to say, it's so important that we speak the Word of God, be prepared to speak the Word to people. Because I'm sure they prayed before they came over, and they were looking for a divine appointment plus a house to rent. Because, let me go back, they're from Vermont, they come out every year and they rent a house, and they usually have seen it online, and this time they'd come and they'd rented a house sight unseen and they didn't like it. So right when I put the ad in the paper, Rich saw it, and nobody else called me but him. I never got any other calls. I couldn't rent my other houses. And so, I mean, what do you think of that? And then God is so good about things. So they came to our house, they were looking around. Like I said, I was kind of nervous because I never do business on Sunday, don't go to the store, and they came in with Cokes in their hands or something, and I thought, but I thought they were really nice. So when they saw that sign, I'm sure they probably both smiled at each other, I don't remember. And Rusty had his back turned to them, and they said, oh, what religion are you? And he whips around in this chair that has wheels, because I was just kind of standing there in my dress, watching him. And he said, well, we're Mormon, but searching. And again, to be prepared is very important, because within 5 minutes, and Rusty will tell this story, when he tells his story, we were all holding hands. And he's thinking, what am I doing holding hands with people? And he'll tell you that was February 1st, 2009, and that was the day he was saved. And then they left. And, my husband and I could just see a change in him, a big change in him. And we continued to read the Bible together, and I was just getting ready to leave to go to California still. I was still going to go to California, get healthy, decide what to do. And I wasn't totally convinced that, we'd still stay together or any of those things. But what happened then was, so Rich called and asked me about the house. And I go, I got to tell you something. My husband doesn't want to rent the house to you. And he goes, oh, well, that's okay. Can we go to dinner? And I thought, yeah, let's do it, And so the four of us went to dinner. And again, I had fallen madly in love with Sean McCraney. And Rusty had been watching him on his show. And he's, did so much. And I was getting ready to leave that. I mean, we went to dinner like on a Thursday. And then I was getting ready to leave on Sunday to go to California. And Rich whips out his phone. And he goes, I got a name of a guy you might know. And it was Sean McCraney. And I go, oh, I'll stay here for another Sunday to go meet him. And so we did, and they were friends with Sean, even though they hadn't been Mormons before. So again, they introduced us to Sean, and we learned an awful lot of stuff. But the day, and then, oh my gosh, they really challenged my religion, because we went and met Sean at a coffee shop on a Sunday. I said, Sean, but I had a Joseph Smith experience, because, you know, in Mormonism, as most of you know, who are Mormons or who have been Mormon, it's so much based on feeling, you know? If you have that burning in your bosom or a feeling that it's right, then that makes it right, no matter what the facts are. So I said, Sean, but I had a Joseph Smith experience there, and I can't let that go. And he said simply to me, and I'll never forget it, he said, feeling, emotions have no intelligence. So, is that what he said? I think that's
or feelings have no intelligence.
Yeah.
Or feelings.
Yeah, feelings have no intelligence. And I thought, wow. And so that just changed me, kind of in a twinkling. And I still went off, and I went to a Calvary church in California, and Rusty became... Rich and Ellen became really good mentors for Rusty, and he learned the Bible inside and out and back and forth. He's very good at it. And so then I came back, a month later, just to visit, and we totally fell in love again. It was so cool after 38 years. And I mean, you know, just the stuff that went back and forth, and we joined a Bikers for Christ. So we had a motorcycle, and we loved that. We joined Bikers for Christ. Well, again, we're back to the then I went back to California, and then while I was there, my mother passed away one day, and my father-in-law passed away the next day. I'd come back, and we went out to the funerals back and forth and that kind of thing. And so we had quite a, you know, an amazing 2 or 3 months there, when our life changed totally because of Christ. Because we developed this relationship with Christ that was so different than when we were Mormon, because I was Mormon and I stayed with my husband. I did so many things out of fear, not out of love. And, you know, I always felt like I was saved ever since that time I was a little kid, but I didn't know the real Jesus. The Jesus I knew had saved me. And, so that was a wonderful, wonderful thing. I just came around full circle. I remembered my Baptist teachings and all those things. And I thought, you know, it's really too bad when some of us as Christians don't speak up, you know, and pray for people all the time. And that's what we're doing here. We want everyone to come to Christ. And all we can do is use, God can use us in whatever way. And so the thing is, after I came back from California and then went to Connecticut and Colorado and all those things settled down, you know, Rusty and I just kind of looked at each other and said, what's going on now? And so in July, as is an appropriate thing to do, we had a family reunion, and we were going to talk about, I said, Rusty, tell everybody about the Bible. You know, just talk to them about the Bible. And, well, it didn't come out the way we would have liked it to. And all five of our kids, our oldest daughter, bless her heart, Joy, she never believed in the church. And she paid a price living with us to not believe in it. Because, you know, we sometimes shamed her, made her feel bad, forced her to go to church, forced her into probably relationships and things she wouldn't have done if we hadn't have been so judgmental. The other four kids were all married in the temple. And you know, the thing, you know, God is so good. It was so great. He came, you know, the way he brought us out of Mormonism. But you know, there's a high price to pay for Christianity. Mm-hmm. And that's what I want to tell people, is that, you know, God's got your back though, no matter what. He's got your back, and he's much more important than your family. Mm-hmm. Even though the Mormon church, that's probably the highest thing they talk about, is your family, and families are forever. And whether they are or not, when you go to your next life, what you believe or not, God's got your back, and he will take care of your family. And he's so, so much bigger than the God of Mormonism, you know? I had him in a box, and he was the pilot, and I was the co-pilot. And that didn't work, and I can't even begin to fathom him now. And you know, one thing about when I was in Mormonism was, you know, going to the temple all the time and not understanding what was going on there. And they'd say, oh, when you become worthy, so to speak, you'll get it. You know, you'll start to get it. And I still didn't understand. One time I was in the temple, and I said, God, help me. Why can't I understand this? Why don't I get big revelations like people do in the temple all the time? And he said, you don't need them. So I don't know what that really stood for, except that he knew I loved God, and he was showing me the way. And I don't know where I was going with that, but going to the temple and people just, you know, getting these revelations and stuff, I thought, well, you know, I have to wear garments. And I took my garments off, and Rusty took his off and didn't wear them. I mean, that's such a big deal to have, you know, as he calls them now, magic underwear. What I also was going to say is that I...
You were at the retreat with your kids.
I was at the retreat with my kids. Yes, that's what I wanted to talk about. The pain that's involved can be... It's still not worse. It's worth every minute of having a relationship with Christ. We told our kids. I told you about my oldest daughter. The other four had been married in the temple. Three out of four of them had been on missions. My kids knew I had greater faith than most people they knew. And so I just thought they'd follow that when we told them the truth, that they would just say, oh yeah, well, Mom, no, she has a lot of faith, and you know, now she's found this out. Well, it didn't happen that way at all. Two of my two daughter-in-laws, which I love dearly, their dads were bishops, and they were all active in the church. And it was like getting a divorce from four kids, and it was very, very painful. And again, another important reason to have good Christian friends. Rich and Elle were always there to listen to our story and pick us up when we were down. And he said, God will use it for good. And we're thinking, oh yeah, right, I don't know. And you know, they wrote us a letter and said, sorry, you've lost the spirit. Hello, as if only Mormons can have the spirit. You know, we still believe all these things. We love you, but you know, we're just sorry that you've turned out this way, basically. And one of my daughters who has four kids, took them away because I wrote something on Facebook, and it was painful. And I guess that's the story I want to tell for people, those of you who are looking and searching and just so afraid that it's going to affect your family. And it is. It'll affect your family forever. But you know what? I, of course, being a Mormon, you know, I had to be able to do it all. And I couldn't do this. I couldn't change my kids. And they were upset with us. And, you know, there was a big divide. And yet we learned to love them even more. And the neat thing was they saw a change in us and a change in our marriage that I tell them that only God could do, and they know that, you know. And now it's been, that was since 2009, and it's been, what, 7 years? Something, 7 bad years, 7 good years. We have a great relationship with them now. Since then, some of them have come out, and they haven't necessarily come to Christ in the way that we have. But they knew that we love them no matter what, and we loved them even more, and we fell in love, and we love our Savior. And it's so funny because my one daughter-in-law says, I know where to shop for you, Hobby Lobby, because she gives me these posters that said, you know, God is good, and they give me ornaments with Bibles, and you know, and they make me brownies, and they call them Jesus nuts and brownies, because that's, I make brownies all the time and love Jesus. And you know, it's kind of interesting, but you know, it's, God has his timing, and he's the one who's talking to our children, and he's there for everybody, and we know that. And I got to let go and let God. And so the journey, like I said, has been painful and yet wonderful, just as wonderful as can be, and in many, many ways. Oh, and I want to go back to the worthiness in the temple. It's a different thing, worthy. I mean, we know that there's none, not one that's good. What's the scripture? None of us are really worthy of what God has done for us and Jesus dying on the cross. But in Mormonism, it's a different kind of worthy. It's like, you know, if you do enough, you will be worthy. And it's like working to be worthy. And to know that God loves us and accepts us just the way we are. And there's always the possibilities that people think, well, you're Christian, you think you can do anything you want to do. Well, sure, I can. I can do anything I want to do. But what I want to do is serve God. And I don't have to keep him in a box. And because I know that he first loved me and I love him, I'm more anxious to do the right things. So it's by grace we are saved, you know, not by any man that could boast. And the neat thing about that is when you truly love, when you learn to love the Savior and you know that he loves you, you just want to do what's best. And it's really been a wonderful, wonderful journey for us. And I just pray that those of you who are searching and looking and doubting and are fearful, there's been many people who have generations of Mormons behind them who have finally come to see that Christ is the answer. And there's many, many Mormons, you know, that if the church isn't true, nothing's true. That's what they tell you. So they leave. And they still believe the church. They don't realize they're still believing the church. That if the church isn't true, nothing's true. That's not true. And so many of you might be lost out there thinking that very thing and not knowing that there's a real God and a real Jesus. And the Bible is the Word of God because we've been taught not to read it. Because if you'd read your Bible, if you'd been taught by the church to read the Bible, you would have discovered Joseph Smith's fraudulent copying of the Bible in many ways, like the whole book of Isaiah. And just a lot of things he talks about, the stone and, you know, in the temple and your names written on stones. He just twisted it. It's, as Sean says, it's called twistianity. And so again, don't be afraid to pray. Don't be afraid to ask God. Because I've said before, if it's true, if it was true before, it'll be true now. If it's not true, you'll know it's not true by asking God to come into your heart and come into your life. Let him know that you're a sinner and that you believe that Jesus died for your sins. And believe me, there's so much more freedom and so much more love and so much more peace. So, that's it.
All right, do you guys have any questions?
I do. I'm curious, since you went to the temple so frequently, and now understanding Christ the way you do, how do you look back on the temple, and what do you think of it now, compared to how you thought of it then?
Oh my, yeah. I was talking about that worthiness. I remember sitting there, you know, you go in through sessions, and people, the men and on one side and the women on the other side. And I remember sitting there, and sometimes it'd be small sessions with 15 women here and 15 men on this side. And I'd look around and I go, are we really that special? Are we the only ones who know about aprons and, you know, cutting the throat and the things that go on that makes it true? And, you know, it really bothers me a lot that I just felt so unworthy for so long, because I'd already, you know, praise upon my type of background that you're just not good enough. And I see the temples, and it bothers me that they're building these billion-dollar temples when kids are dying in the street, like in Tijuana, things like that. So that's how I feel about that.
Did it freak you out at first when you first went in with your background?
To the temple?
Yeah. What'd you think?
I could tell you some stories about that, but I won't because I'm on tape. But I went in with my family and my husband. That was the first time. See, long ago, a lot of times you don't go first, and they don't tell you. This is the other thing, talking about being freaked out about it. Mormonism, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, going to church and going to the temple are two different religions almost. You don't talk about it. You can't talk about it in church. You can't talk about what goes on. You just talk about someday, you know, the kids saying, I'm going there someday, I love to see the temple. I mean, gosh, if they would tell them what they have to do going in there, a lot of people probably wouldn't go. Did it freak me out? It was just different. It was really different, and I was so faithful, I so believed it must be true, even though it was weird. It was very, it was just different, but I just believed it all.
Well, did you have experiences with the dead in the temple when you were going through, like some people say they have? And then what do you think of that now?
Oh, about being baptized for the dead?
Well, I mean, like some people say, oh, I felt my ancestor, I had my sacred experience in the temple. And then, see, looking back from the Christian perspective, the person's gone. I mean, that was some other, you know, source. What's your thoughts or experience?
Well, it was very quiet in the temple. Sometimes I see people that would remind me of ancestors. But I think the answer that God gave me in the temple was, you don't need these experiences. Because, you know, like I said, people are having revelations. Oh, I saw my grandfather. All those things. So I think God put me at rest at that. Yeah,
that's good.
Yeah. I think you said that Rusty started having questions first. Is that right?
Yeah.
Do you remember specifically what his main concerns were? And did those become your main concerns? Or, I mean, how did you, ultimately, what led you out, you personally?
The Bible. It was the Bible and Jesus, you know. That's what took me out, because anything he said was not true, because I didn't believe that. I didn't believe that Joseph Smith had 35 wives. I don't know. What else did you tell me, Rusty? I mean, he would just tell me things like, oh, brother, he is nuts now, you know, on top of everything else. And I just didn't want to listen. But I said, if you can tell me something positive, I'll listen. So there were just many things, and we just had bad experiences with some people. And we know that, you know, Rusty was very active in the church. He was a 70. He was probably the longest 70. He was a 70 when they had 70s that were ward and stake 70s, and they taught him to, he had to home teach. He had 5 kids on the road all the time, home teaching, and if everybody didn't do their home teaching, he'd be on their case, and he would do it for him so he could get the best marks for having the home teaching completed. And he was a missionary in the ward where he'd have to go out on the nights that he was home. Meanwhile, our daughter in 4th grade was smoking marijuana and things like that, because we were just too busy in the church to really take the time to, you know, it's hard enough to have 5 kids to just really take the time and take care of them, a lot of those things. So, and the other thing was, when I was in high school, after I joined the church, I'd only been in the church about a year, and one of my best friends was black. And that's when we had the long seats on the cars. She came and picked me up with her mom, and her mom was on one side, and she was on the other side. And she goes, Mom, tell Barbara, the Mormons don't accept the blacks in the church. And I'm going, I'm right between the two of them. And I don't know what they said or anything, but I thought, that couldn't be true. So I asked my bishop, and he explained it away, and I believed it. So that was interesting. But it wasn't until, like I said, he had a lot of questions, a lot of doubts, and would bug me about it, and I didn't want to hear it. And like I said, it wasn't until he started reading me the Bible, and God just pulled me out in just a short time. And then I started studying the a lot of the things myself, you know. And of course, the thing that hit me was, you know, Sean talking about the word of wisdom, and about, you know, that he lied about things in the Bible that I could discern, because I had studied the Bible a little bit when I was younger. So it doesn't help to tell people what's wrong with the church. It just helps. I learned to tell people what's right with Jesus.
What reflecting back, when both you and Russ were embarrassed about seeking the truth, what spirit or what influence made you feel embarrassed between each other about seeking the truth?
I'm not sure I understand.
Well, you said that when you were both sneaking off watching, you know, Sean, it was like you were embarrassed to be caught seeking the truth. What spirit do you think it was, or what influence?
Oh, what influence was it? Yeah. I don't know. I thought it was, I think it now, I mean, I realize it was just God drawing us, but I didn't want to have to let go of something that I believed for 40 years. See, and we were both in the church over 40 years, and it just goes to show. I have a niece back in Connecticut, and she's a great, great Christian girl, and her name is Lynn, and she prayed for us for 40 years to come out of the church. And when I finally told her to come out, she could not believe it. It was so exciting. So I'm sure it was her and everybody. Rusty's good friend, Curtis, who had just been faithful to us all that time and was always, you know, giving him little pamphlets and little things. And he's like, yeah, you know, get on with my home teaching type thing. But then there was just, yeah, so that's kind of what happened.
So when you're drilled for so long that the Bible, you can't really trust it, it's got these errors and the plain and precious truths business, all this stuff, what was it that drew you to the Bible?
Well, it was Rusty reading it to me, but what drew him was because he couldn't find any answers in the Book of Mormon that he wanted.
So what made you think that the Bible was true after you've been taught this whole time that you really can't trust the Bible? What was it?
I think I can only say it was God, because I would just say, like I said, I remember things that he was teaching that I'd heard when I was young, but I would say, I thought Joseph Smith said that. I thought he said that. And when he said he didn't, I thought, I don't know. I mean, I never had this big burning thing. It was just like, oh my gosh. It's just like all of a sudden it was true, and it was great and good. And you know, Mormonism was a lie, and that was so huge, you know. But I didn't, you know, a lot of people, they just struggle for years and years and years with their families, because again, you know, they don't want to hurt their families. I watched my daughter-in-law go through this and stuff. Finally, you come to a point that you just realize, well, this is too many lies, too much of a cult. I can't take it anymore. But with me, I don't know what it was. I got the Bible. I knew it was God drew me, and instantly I was out and never thought, looked back and thought, oh, the church might be true or any of those things. I knew it was wrong. But, you know, again, the hardest part was with the kids and maybe not going about it. One of the things about doing that, coming out that fast, I mean, I hear Bishop Earle, what, he studied for 7 years and didn't even tell his wife, you know. I thought, I'd go crazy over that one. And, I'd be thinking all kinds of things too, Carla. So, but, you know, it's just very short for me, and I know that Rusty struggled for a long time, and I just watched him change, and, you know, God, you know, drew me. So that was it. It was really very fast. Yeah.
How does your freedom differ from the quote-unquote freedom perception of a Mormon now?
Their freedom, well, they think they have the truth, and I always thought, you know, the Bible was good, but we had, you know, Christians were good, but Mormons had even more truth. And my freedom in Christ is just to know that our God is an awesome God. He's so big, and I used to have him in a box. And I didn't have freedom. I mean, I think I was, like, born again. I mean, I'd go to church, and I'd bear my testimony all the time and say, I believe Joseph Smith is a God, but I know Jesus is the Christ, I would say all the time. And I would say, oh, I feel like a spoiled child, you know, that God just loves me no matter what. So, but a lot of my life was based on fear, you know. I mean, wearing the garments, make sure your sleeves are right, and, you know, not being able to wear short shorts, things like that. Not that I do, you know, really, but that. So it was based on fear. More than love, you know, and it was a fear. You know, we're supposed to fear the Lord, our God, in a loving, awesome, supreme, omnipotent way. But I feared him, you know, like, ooh, if I don't do everything the Mormon Church tells me to, I won't make it.
So you're fearing the Mormon Church, not God.
Yeah, yeah.
That's a really big difference, don't you think?
Yes, mm-hmm. You're exactly right.
That's profound.
What's that?
That's profound.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and, you know, the other thing, one day we were, And it is, it's like a death too for us coming out of the church and stuff. So a lot of anger goes on, you know, most of you, some of you are thinking of coming out or haven't gone out, you're afraid, afraid to look at the truth. And some people are angry because they've spent so much time and being told and forced to do things and stuff. And then you're just really angry. Well, we experience some anger in ourselves, obviously, with that happening. And then one day we're sitting on the couch and reading the Bible in the morning, and I just said, "Hey, Rusty, we've been in the church 40 years, and we finally made it to the promised land. So let's be happy and not look back." So at that point, I just said, "That's it." And so, you know, the journey of Moses was in the desert was really only supposed to be a journey of 11 days, and it was 40 years for us. And sometimes we get mad, but there was a reason, you know, there's just a reason for that. And I just say, let's not get mad about it, you know.
That's awesome.
Yeah, so we're going to write a book sometimes, this 40 years in the desert. Maybe.
That's for
years in the Mormon desert.
Yeah.
The desert, that's why they call it the Deseret.
In the lovely Deseret.
So. Would you say that your understanding of who God is and who Jesus is distinctly different now than it was before?
It is, in that who can, for me, who can really describe God and Jesus, except that I know that Jesus is I have a personal relationship with him, that he's a loving Savior who loves me and has saved me. And before, I mean, I think I knew that, but I didn't study that. You know, it wasn't that big of a deal as it is now. It's all about Jesus now. Before it was about Jesus, it was about Book of Mormon, the church, Joseph, and a little Jesus. But I did, the Jesus I knew I loved and I knew he cared for me. But now it's really cool.
You know what, that's pretty profound. I think that that's very true, that they look at Jesus as a little Jesus and...
Yeah.
Not now, huh?
Yeah. There's no Joseph to show me the way.
just the way, the truth, and the life, huh?
Right.
Did you guys sit down and get your names removed?
Yes, that's another thing we did. We went and had our names removed about a year into the church. Yeah, and at that time, it was a lot harder than it is to do now. Of course, now, you know, they have the movements, and they go down there and sign 2,000 names, and there's an attorney who, maybe there's more than one, who willingly removes our names. But, you know, there's just nothing like it. I mean, it is so cool. Like, I can talk to a Protestant and a Baptist, and I can go to their church and not be reprimanded for it or, you know, stuff. And they all believe that, you know, as long as we all believe the same thing. But we... I said, Rusty, I just don't want, I mean, I don't know if that was still Mormon thinking or not, but I thought, I want God to know that I don't want anything to do with that church. And one of the ways for me was to take our names off the records. And we had to demand, I mean, and the way that went about was not nice, because we demanded that nobody come and bug us and tell us this and that and try to encourage us, because they'd write letters and say, you know, you can come back, you know, even though you've sinned, you know, we'll help you come back. And everybody, you know, would think that we probably left the church because we sinned, you know. And so when we sent the letter in, it took like 3 or 4 weeks to still get a confirmation that our name was no longer on the record and we were allowed to come back if we wanted to. And if Rusty tells his story sometime, he has a great story about how the home teachers would come, and when he told them not to... They're welcome to come anytime as long as we just talked about Jesus, and they wouldn't come anymore. So,
do your kids know you did that? You took your name off the record?
Yes, that's what I was going to say. Yeah, one of them found out, and she was just heartbroken and said, you know, what do I do? She kept going to the temple, and she said, do we have to not associate with them? Because there's a question in the 10 or 12 questions that they ask you to be worthy to go to the temple if you have anything to do with apostates. Mm-hmm. And we had become apostates.
Wow.
And yet they knew how much we loved them. We loved them dearly. So, and they were the first ones to leave that I thought would be the last ones to leave.
Wow.
So,
yeah.
Thank you.
Anything else?
What a mighty Savior.
Yeah, God is good. So, you know, I just plead with people and Mormons out there that are doubting to, you know, read the Bible, start reading the Bible. And, you know, some people say start with the book of John. I think that's a great book. You know, I really was converted through, I mean, as far as one of the books I love the most is Romans, you know, and study that. So, and just be willing to reach out. Call me, call Rob. He's a wonderful person who just has dedicated his life to helping people find truth. And it's so freeing. So please do that. Please do that.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. What about your family, your daughters and the divorce? They now, you preach the gospel to them? Or you preach the gospel to your kids?
Do I teach it to our kids? Oh, yeah. They call, Rich probably doesn't know this, but Rusty, my son calls Rich and Rusty the teachers, the elders. Whenever they talk to him about the Bible. We don't talk to him out and out and say what's wrong with the church, but Rusty is such a verbose, you know, just a cornucopia of knowledge of the Bible that it just comes out.
Quotes word all the time.
Yeah, speaks the word all the time and stuff and tells people, you know, and gee, if you put, you know, do this in Hebrew and Greek means this and that, you know, they really gets into it. So they know where to go if they need to, if they want to know more about Jesus. So, but we don't push it on them, you know, okay. Like we used to try to show them what wasn't right.
That's a good joke.
Yeah. We joke a little about a few mm-hmm. things, and they seem to be okay with it.
All right, would you close us in prayer?
Sure. Oh God, the Eternal Father, Heavenly Father, we just love you, and we thank you for our many, many, many blessings, and just the biggest one is just to know who you are, and even though you're beyond my comprehension, this having this relationship with you has just been so incredible, and the trip and the journey, as painful as it could be, is so rewarding. We pray, dear Lord, that you will bring others, draw others to you, and that you would give us boldness as Christians to speak to those who might be searching, but we never know who it is. So we need to, in our everyday walk, be willing to speak out and with boldness and seasoned with salt, the scripture says, to speak of you and to live like you would have us live so that our lives reflect who you are. And we so thank you for this great congregation of friends and ex-Mormons here, people who love Jesus, people who love the Mormons. We love Mormon people, and we just pray that we could be a witness for you in all things. And continue to bless Rob and his family and his ministry. Blessing with abundance of blessings of all kinds and any kind of need they may have in as they go forward. And again, we thank you for all of our many blessings, and we do it in the name of Jesus Christ.
Jesus.
Amen. 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 Amen.